Hi dear students, how are you all? I hope all of you are fine. Here, I'm Sushma ma'am. I'm taking bio. Now during this lockdown holidays, because of this pandemic situation, we are totally depending online sessions as we cannot do any kind of compromise with academics. We have to depend the sessions there, and for that maximum effort, in a perfect way, we are trying to give you. And during the online sessions, online live sessions, teachers would have given the instructions to you as per the instruction given. You have to follow the same in any of the subject regarding uploaded video, while preparing notes, anywhere. If any problem you are facing, feel free to come and meet teachers personally. Most of the students are coming, they are discussing with teachers, clearing their doubts, submitting the notes. So very good response we are getting from you all. And when the online live session was going on, that time your subject teachers would have given the clear idea regarding revised syllabus in each subject. How many chapters deleted completely? From some of the subjects, some of the chapters, few topics deleted. Like the same, with me, Chirag sir is there. Usually I am just handling first unit in 11th standard. Rest all the units, Chirag sir is only taking. So in this first unit, what we have to learn, what no need to learn, or we can omit. This instruction would have been given by Chirag sir. But once again, as I am going to start the first unit, I want to discuss with you that according to the revised syllabus and deleted topics, in this first unit, that is unit 1, diversity in the living world, 4 chapters are there. Chapter 1, the living world. Chapter 2, biological classification. Chapter 3, plant kingdom. And chapter 4, animal kingdom. From this second and fourth chapter, nothing is omitted. We have to learn the chapter totally. First chapter, that is the living world, in that from the intro to binomial nomenclature only we have to learn, rest all the topics are deleted. And in third chapter, last two topics, angiosperms and plant life cycle and alternation of generations are omitted. Anyhow, we are going to start the first chapter from unit 1, that is chapter 1, the living world. Before starting the chapter, as our subject is biology, you have to tell me what you mean by biology. Otherwise, how the word originated? Anybody knows? Yes. Biology means the study of life. Bios means life, and logos means study. And in biology, different branches also there. As it is dealt with study of life, in this vast universe, many things are there which we are seeing, we are observing, we are understanding. Apart from all these, many more things are there which we are not having any awareness. So in this chapter, we are going to learn about the living world. What's the name of the chapter? Chapter 1, the living world. In this chapter, mainly we are going to focus about 4 topics. But from that, last 2 topics already deleted. But again, we can see that which are the topics included in this chapter. First of all, what is living? Diversity in the living world. Taxonomic categories and taxonomical aids. These last 2 topics are deleted from the syllabus. So that's why I told you that we are going to learn from this chapter up to where? Binomial nomenclature. So let's start. Good. Please take out the textbook. Chapter 1, the living world. One more point I have to discuss with you that in our school, we are having a system with the chapters only, we are covering the neat portions also. For that, one material is providing to you. So, in that also, whatever extra information is given, that usually we are discussing. Exercises part, solving them. Doubts are clearing. And in this unit, first 2 chapters, that is the living world and biological classification, these 2 chapters are included in the same material. Even the 3rd chapter actually. So 3 chapters in the same material it is there. From that 3rd we can keep it separate. First 2 lessons after completion of the chapter from the textbook, we can go through the extra relevant informations which one is given in the material. So first of all, what I am planning that I will complete these 2 chapters from the textbook. Then after, we will have a look on which one the material. Ready for that? Good. Now, we are going to start. Please listen. How wonderful is the living world? The wide range of living types is amazing. See the sentence. How wonderful is the living world? Obviously, when we are looking around, when we are going to a particular area or a particular region, or from one state to another, yeah, from one country to another, we can see the difference in all aspects related to nature, related to creatures. Everywhere the range, the wide range we can see. So dear students, that's the first sentence we are saying. How wonderful is the living world? The wide range of living types is amazing. Even you would have learned from lower classes, we are learning that. Right? Microbes are there. Microbes means microorganisms. What are microorganisms? Yes, which we cannot see with our naked eyes. For that, what we have to take the help of? Very good, microscope. So that means from microscopic organisms to very gigantic organisms, giant organisms we can see. So that's why we are saying the wide range of living types is amazing, interesting, astonishing. The extraordinary habitats in which we find living organisms, be it called mountains, deciduous forest, oceans, freshwater lakes, deserts, or hot springs,
leave us speechless.
So what we are seeing here, the extraordinary habitats. We are not saying about the normal habitat. What do you mean by habitat? Yes, where the organism is living. That area, surrounding area altogether is known as what? Habitat. So the extraordinary, it's different from usually a normal, that is extraordinary habitats in which we find living organisms. We can see living organisms even in the extraordinary habitats also. It can be called mountains, deciduous forest. That means the forest where the trees are falling their leaves. You would have learned this topic in detail. One of the geography chapter in your 10th standard. Even in 9th, 10th, these topics are coming there. Lower classes also it's coming. 6th onwards, these topics coming there. So here we are saying that in extraordinary habitats also, we can find living organisms. It can be called mountains. So called mountains also organisms are living. Deciduous forest also it is there. Even in oceans, then freshwater lakes, deserts. Can you imagine? Can we stay in deserts? It will be very difficult. So hot. But camels are living there and they are having that particular adaptations. Even the plants, when we are seeing cactus like plants, it is growing very nicely there. But these living beings have particular adaptations. Any of the habitat is there, the organisms are having some special adaptations to adjust with the surroundings there. So what we are seeing here, even hot springs, you see that hot springs, springs means small rivers, no, hot springs. And springs, hot means it's too hot, the water is so hot. Usually organisms cannot survive in that. But even in that condition also, some of the organisms are able to live. So all these matters are really astonishing to us. And they are leaving us speechless. We have nothing to say. We are getting shocked. We are getting astonished after seeing the wonder of the nature. And the beauty of a galloping horse. What do you mean by galloping horse? Have you ever seen the scenery of horse which is going to jump like that, that posture? Yes, that is only galloping horse. That means racing horse. Of the migrating birds. How beautiful the scene is there. Now, migrating birds, even when the climate is changing, when the atmosphere is not suitable for them, so what they are doing? What do you mean by migration? It's a temporary change from one place to another. Wherever the atmosphere is suitable for them, so they are searching for that and they are moving from that original place to there. And when again that original place or habitat become natural for them, good for them, comfortable for them, so they are coming back also there. So that is known as migration. And these migrating birds, they have an order, they are having a particular order, their movement is so beautiful. One leader like that in front will be there, all others in a particular line they are following there. So next we can see that the valley of flowers, the valley where totally all the plants with the beautiful flowers, with different colors of flowers there, and or the attacking shark evokes awe and deep sense of wonder. Means attacking shark, the shark which is going to attack anything or anyone, so that scene, otherwise that situation is also evokes. Evokes means, what do you mean by evokes? Having, that means it creates a feeling of fear and wonder at a time. So once we are getting astonished, and at the same time, we are having fear also there. So such types of situations also there. So that we are saying that what? Attacking shark evokes awe. Awe means fear and wonder. And even a deep sense of wonder. So this is just an introductory paragraph to express the beauty of nature and its creatures. See the next point. The ecological conflict and cooperation among members of a population and among populations of a community, or even the molecular traffic inside a cell, make us deeply reflect on what indeed is life. Dear students, please see the sentence once again. The ecological conflict and cooperation among members of a population and among populations of a community. You have to understand that population means it's a group of members, and community means it's a group of population. So in an ecological condition, we can see that within a population itself, sometimes within the members, what happens? Conflicts happen, and sometimes cooperation is also there. And the same we can see in the case of a community. So there also what is happening there? In between the population, cooperation is also there, and sometimes the conflict is also there. And even the molecular traffic inside a cell. So not only among the members of a population, not only among populations of a community, even the same we can see where the molecular traffic inside a cell make us deeply reflect on what indeed is life. So what do you mean by molecular traffic inside a cell? Traffic we have heard. Unusual basis, on daily basis we are facing also there. But what is this molecular traffic inside a cell? Please write down, dear students, note down the point. Molecular traffic inside a cell. Let me start. Okay. All aspects of DNA metabolism. All aspects of DNA metabolism hyphen including transcription, replication and repair. Once again, all aspects of DNA metabolism including transcription, replication and repair involve motor enzymes that move along genomic DNA. That move along genomic DNA. Full stop. These processes must all take place on chromosomes that are occupied by a large number of other proteins. Once again, listen. All aspects of DNA metabolism, including transcription, replication and repair, involve motor enzymes that move along genomic DNA. These processes must also take place on chromosomes that are occupied by a large number of other proteins. In short, molecular traffic of inside a cell, you have to understand that it's nothing else but what is that? All aspects of DNA metabolism. Okay? And regarding this topic, Chirag sir will teach you in unit 3, cell structure and functions. So you will get a very good and a clear picture regarding these topics there. And now, see that point once again. The ecological conflict and cooperation among members of a population and among populations of a community, or even the molecular traffic inside a cell, make us deeply reflect on what indeed is life. This question has two implicit questions within it. Here what we are saying, this question has two implicit questions within it, and in the same question It has another two questions which are implicit in there. Miss, what do you mean by the word implicit? Please write down. Implicit means essentially connected with. What is the meaning of the word? Essentially connected with. It's very essential. Because when we are asking this question, what indeed is life? And the same question has two more questions which are essentially connected with that. The first is a technical one. The first question is a technical one. And seek the answer to what living is as opposed to the non-living. Means, first question, or means as we are discussing that two implicit questions are there. From that, the first one is a technical one. And that question seeks answer to what living is as opposed to the non-living. So, what is the difference between living and non-living? This is from lower classes we are learning there. And the next, and the second is a philosophical one. And seeks answer to what the purpose of life is. Means, what is the second question? The second implicit question is that it's a philosophical one. And that philosophical question, in what indeed life, seeks answer to what the purpose of life is. Otherwise, what is the purpose of the life? So, that is a philosophical question. But as scientists, we shall not attempt answering the second question. Which is the second question? The philosophical one. And what it seeks answer? It seeks answer to the purpose of life is. Or what is the purpose of life? What the purpose of life is. But as biology students or as scientists, we shall not attempt answering the second question, that is the philosophical one. We will try to reflect on what is living. So, dear students, I think the first paragraph, there is nothing to learn or by heart like that, just to understand. It was an intro topic. Now, we are going to start the topic, that is, what is living? And before going to the topic only, I have to tell you that, when coming to binomial nomenclature and the topic, it is really interesting there. But here, what we are going to learn, if we are going in depth, you will be confused. Instead of that, just understanding and going ahead, that will be better for you and it will be easy to understand also. We will discuss all the points. Because as we are scientists, we have to understand what is living. Okay, let's see students. What is living? When we try to define living, we conventionally look for distinctive characteristics exhibited by living organisms. See the sentence. When we try to define living, whenever we are going to define living word, so we usually... Conventionally means we have to understand the meaning of the word usually, normally, ordinary. So, we normally look for distinctive characteristics, otherwise particular characteristics or specific characteristics exhibited by living organisms. That's true. Whenever we have to explain living, so we are telling that from lower classes we are learning that living things can grow, living things can move, and non-living things cannot grow, non-living things cannot move. So like that we were learning. So what we are usually doing, we are seeing some distinctive characteristics. We are seeing some specific characteristics which is exhibited by the living organisms. Growth, reproduction, ability to sense environment, and mount a suitable response to come to our mind immediately as unique features of living organisms. That means whenever we are going to define living, usually these characteristics are coming to our mind. First of all, growth. Living things can grow. Living things reproduce. Right? And they can sense the environment. So, all these types of characteristics are usually coming in our mind when we are going to discuss or define about living. So, see that once again, growth, reproduction, ability to sense environment and make a suitable response. Means ability to sense environment and make a suitable response. That is continuously you have to understand altogether. What that? Ability to sense environment and mount a suitable response or make a suitable response. That means if any dog is coming behind you, so what you have to do? You have to just stand and take the bite of that? Not at all. We have to do the response. Either we can move from there, and if running, so obviously it will come behind you. Since dog that, some other way we have to find out. Otherwise, when we are touching a hot object, we will keep it for burning? No. As soon as the sensation we are getting, so we are taking our hand back. So that is the sentence here means. What? Ability to sense the environment and mount a suitable response come to our mind immediately as unique features of living organisms. If we are pouring hot water on a non-living thing, it does not run away. But if the same thing is happening with a living creature, obviously the response will be there. So that's only we have to understand. One can add a few more features like metabolism, ability to self-replicate, self-organize, interact and emergence to this list. Listen once again. So the main points we told, grow, reproduction, ability to sense environment and mount a suitable response. Apart from these, we can add some more features related to living, that is metabolism. Metabolism, you have to understand, it's a biochemical process. It includes both catabolism and anabolism. Catabolism is a reduction process and anabolism means it's a creative process there. And here, one can add a few more features like metabolism, ability to self-replicate, self-organize, interact and emergence to this list. Means interact and emergence. Interaction with others. Okay, all these points are adding with the points which we already taught. So growth, reproduction, ability to sense environment and make a suitable response. Then after, which one? Yes, metabolism, ability to self-replicate, self-organize, interact and emergence. So let us try to understand each of these. So from these all characteristics, as we discussed, when we try to define living, we normally look for distinctive characteristics exhibited by living organisms such as growth, reproduction, ability to sense environment and make a suitable response. Then after adding when other characteristics such as metabolism, ability to self-replicate, self-organize and interact and emergence. So now we are going to learn, dear students, from these characteristics one by one in detail. First, all living organisms grow. So what is the first point or first characteristic we can say? All living organisms grow. Increase in mass and increase in number of individuals are twin characteristics of growth. Dear students, this point is very, very important. You have to underline that. You have to learn that even in NEET exam also. This question is asking that. Okay? So, all living organisms grow. So, which are the twin characteristics of growth? That question can be asked. So, which are the twin characteristics of growth? Increase in mass and increase in number of individuals. Means, if we are considering the case of individuals, in that if the mass is increasing and even the number is increasing, so these are the two characteristics of growth. So all living organisms grow. What is the first point? Increase in mass and increase in number of individuals are twin characteristics of growth. A multicellular organism grows by cell division. What do you mean by multicellular organism? Yes, very good. The organism which is made up of more than one cell, they are known as what? Multicell. So we are coming under which one? Yes, very good. Multicellular organisms. And if it is made up of only single cell, then it is known as what? Yes, unicellular organisms. So now we are selling multicellular organisms. A multicellular organism grows by cell division. So which is the method there? Cell division. In plants, this growth by cell division occurs continuously throughout their lifespan. At this point, you have to understand from lower classes when we are learning the difference. We were saying that what plants, they are continuously growing till their death. But animals, or in the case of human beings, a particular growth is there, then after it stops. Means height wise. But becoming fatty. And all these things are happening there. But what is happening? As compared to plant, increase in height is getting stopped. But in plants, it is continuous throughout the lifespan. So here we told the point, a multicellular organism grows by cell division. In plants, this growth by cell division occurs continuously throughout their lifespan. Till the death of the plant, it's growing only there. In animals, this growth is seen only up to a certain age. But in the case of animals, this growth is seen only up to a certain age. However, cell division occurs in certain tissues to replace lost cells. But it doesn't mean that thereafter cell division is not happening. It happens mainly for what purpose? It occurs in certain tissues to replace lost cells. For example, you know that whenever any wound or injury is happening, even scars coming there, means cut is coming there, but afterwards it's getting rejoined. That is because of that particular tissues, what happened? Division of cells happened, new cells formed, and the as same as of earlier, it is coming back. Okay, so that what we are saying here, the point. In animals, this growth is seen only up to a certain age. However, cell division occurs in certain tissues to replace lost cells. Unicellular organisms grow by cell division. Even in the case of unicellular organism also, it's growing by cell division. One can easily observe this in vitro cultures by simply counting the number of cells under the microscope. So here in vitro culture, simply you have to understand what that is, test tube culture. What is in vitro culture? Test tube culture. So one can easily observe this. What you can observe? The cell division. In which one? In vitro culture or test tube culture. How we can understand that? By simply counting the number of cells under the microscope. In majority of higher animals and plants, growth and reproduction are mutually exclusive events. One must remember that increase in body mass is considered as growth. Listen once again the point which one was told earlier. In majority of higher animals and plants, growth and reproduction are mutually exclusive events. One must remember that increase in body masses is considered as growth. Non-living objects also grow if we take increase in body mass as a criterion for growth. So now here we are going to compare with living and non-living thing on the basis of the characteristic, that is all living things grow. So if we are saying that all living things grow, in that the first point we told that increase in mass and increase in number of individuals are the twin characteristic of growth. So now if we are considering increase in mass as a criterion, listen here. In majority of higher animals that we told, okay, One must remember that increase in body mass is considered as growth. Non-living objects also grow if we take increase in body mass as a criterion for growth. What is that? Mountains, boulders and sand mounds do grow. You can see that mountain is there. Even boulders, that means mountain-like structures, and sand mounds. So means what we are seeing that whenever this mountain, your boulder, your sand mounds, when the particles are adding on that, its size is getting increased. And the sand mound size can be increased. For example, in the case of a desert, you can see vast area totally covered with the desert there and sand there. And that sand, because of wind, if it is gathered at one place, so its size is also increasing. So we cannot say that in that case, increase in mass is a characteristic of living being. Because in that case, what is happening, as we are seeing the case of non-living, also the size is increasing. That means increase in mass is happening there. Okay? So listen, how about this kind of growth exhibited by non-living objects is by accumulation of material on the surface. As I discussed with you, in the case of mountain, your boulder, your sand mounds, this growth is occurring because of what? By the accumulation of material on the surface. In living organisms, growth is from inside. But when we are comparing with living beings, there the case is different. What is that? In living organism, growth is from inside, not from outside. If in our body, if something is added, our size is not going to be increased. It can be possible in the case of only non-living things. Our size is increasing from where? Inside. Growth, therefore, cannot be taken as a defining property of living organisms. So actually in this chapter, what we are going to do is that from the lower classes, whatever characteristics we have learned as the living things and non-living things, what difference is there, what are the characteristics there, what are the features there. And then coming to the higher level, the level of the topic is also increasing. According to that, as we learned earlier, growth is a defining feature of living beings, but now we are saying that we cannot consider growth as a defining property of living organism. Conditions under which it can be observed in all living organisms have to be explained, and then we understand that it is a characteristic of living systems. A dead organism does not grow. A dead organism does not grow. Conditions under which it can be observed that all living organisms have to be explained, and then we understand that it is a characteristic of living system. A dead organism does not grow. In short, from this paragraph, you have to understand what earlier the characteristic growth, which was considered as a unique feature of living organism, but after understanding that, as we are considering the twin characteristic of living organism, increase in mass and increase in number of individuals, if we are considering increase in mass, then we understood that in the case of non-living things like mountain, boulders, sand dunes, if we are considering increase in mass, even they are also growing by the accumulation of particles on the surface. So we are seeing here the first characteristic, that is growth, we cannot take or cannot be taken as a defining property of living organisms. Okay, dear students, today in this first session, we are just learning this much only then. Please read the topic, try to understand. Rest of the topics we will learn in detail in the next session. Thank you so much for all of you. Take care of yourself. Stay safe and stay healthy. Once again, thank you so much.